Hello. I hope you can hear me. Welcome to the class. Now talking about the subject, I have given the heading three names: miscarriage, abortion, and I have added to it repeated pregnancy loss. It is not quite abortion or miscarriage, but because this is the way most of our patients present to us in the hospital, in our outpatient, in our clinic. So I thought I should put some emphasis on this as well, because when you become doctors, this is how you're going to face the problem. First of all, definition. Definition of abortion is a pregnancy loss that occurs at less than, I put two figures, 24 and 28 weeks of gestation. These two are, because internationally it is 24 weeks. Because after 24 weeks of pregnancy, internationally the pregnancy is considered viable. That if the baby is born after 24 weeks, then the baby can survive. But in Pakistan, because of the facilities, they are not as good as everywhere. So that's why we still talk about viability at 28 weeks. Clinically, we talk about viability in management of patients as 28 weeks. If baby is delivered before 28 weeks, the viability is very, very low and very difficult. So for you in the examination and in your theory paper, you will write 24 weeks. But in practice, it is clinically, we use 28 weeks still. It is old-fashioned, but still we use 28. So for your examination purposes, abortion is a pregnancy loss that occurs at less than 24 weeks. As a matter of fact, WHO, they have reduced even 24 to 22 weeks. So because the neonatal care is getting better all over the world, so baby born after 22 weeks can survive with intensive care. So that's why WHO definition brings it down to 28. Then the other terminology which is used, spontaneous abortion or miscarriage, that they are synonymous. Both mean same thing. May occur in the absence of any medical or surgical intervention. So any if abortion takes place after any medication or any intervention, then that is not spontaneous abortion. Today we are talking about spontaneous abortion, which is defined as I said earlier. And the other definition, pregnancy loss before viability of the fetus. I've told you about viability. Internationally, 24 weeks, Pakistan, 28 weeks. But that in practice, in theory, when you go to the examination, you will say 24 weeks because that's the figure given in the textbooks. And so pregnancy loss before viability of the fetus, that is less than 24 weeks in Pakistan, I said 28, is called miscarriage or abortion. If it happens more than once, it is called repeated pregnancy loss or repeated or recurrent abortion. I said the WHO definition is the expulsion of fetus or an embryo weighing less than 500 gram, and also a gestation age limit is 22 completed weeks. So that's a strict WHO definition for abortion. Incidence is difficult to quote. There's no data which can fix exactly, but general impression is that it is 15 to 20%. Why is it difficult to assess? Because sometimes the patient is pregnant, but she doesn't realize that there was pregnancy, and after short amenorrhea, she aborts. She doesn't even realize that was abortion. She feels it was delayed menses. And sometimes it is other way around. The patient has short amenorrhea, not because of pregnancy, because of other gynecological reasons, and she presumes it was pregnancy. And without confirmation, after short amenorrhea, the menses come, whereas she had never been pregnant, but she presumes it is pregnancy. So that's why the data collection becomes difficult. Coming to etiology, there are multiple causes for that. Innumerable, as a matter of fact. You name any medical, surgical, gynecological problem, it does cause, lead to abortion. But if we put it in short list, I have made this list, the most common is chromosomal anomalies. First trimester abortions, nearly 50% of them, nearly 50% of first trimester abortions are because of chromosomal anomalies. Chromosomal anomaly could be anything, aneuploidy, and genetic problems, and all kinds of difficulties, extra chromosome, trisomy 21, or monosomy, or anything. So multiple chromosomal anomalies, they are responsible for 50% of first trimester abortions. Then there could be problem in the uterus, developmental problem, that uterus is not properly formed. Either it is unicornuate or bicornuate or septate, any difficulty in the uterus where the pregnancy is going to grow, the baby is going to live for 9 months. If the space is limited, obviously, then there will be difficulty. The endocrinological upset in the body, all kinds, maybe thyroid, maybe progesterone, maybe any other PCO, that leads to endocrinological disturbance. They can cause abortion. Any acute or chronic infection, particularly there are some infections which are more commonly seen in the genital tract, though they can be more. But any acute fever, any chronic illness, they cannot. Then immunological difficulties, autoimmune diseases or some immune deficiency, they can cause abortion. And obviously, lifestyle also has an impact on this. Then, talking about chromosomal anomalies, aneuploidy, as I said earlier, 50% of early abortions, or developmental defects, baby is not properly formed, congenital anomalies. God has been extremely kind to human beings, to us. Because if the baby is abnormal, generally speaking, the baby does not deliver at term where pregnancy is lost as abortion earlier on. Any abnormality of the baby, there's a high risk of abortion. In the uterus, I said, congenital defects like septum in the uterus, unicornuate, bicornuate, and fibroids in the uterus. Fibroids as such cannot. They do not. But if the fibroid is distorting uterine cavity, that is intramural or submucous fibroid, then the abortion can take place. Similarly, Eshelman syndrome is adhesions in the uterine cavity. Because of the presence of adhesions, then either there's amenorrhea, pregnancy doesn't take place. If it does, the baby doesn't grow there. So Eshelman syndrome can be, or adhesions in the uterine cavity can cause abortion. Then cervical incompetence. You know, during 9 months of gestation, the internal loss of the cervical canal is kept tightly closed to retain the products of conception, that is baby. But if there's weakness at that internal loss, then it opens up earlier, particularly during second trimester, and the baby comes out in before viability. That means abortion takes place. The cervical incompetence is the most common cause of second trimester abortions. The cervical incompetence could be due to congenital defect in the uterus, congenital weakness, or acquired due to some procedure on the uterus like DNC, excessive dilatation, or injury to the internal loss. These are various forms of uterine anomalies, unicornuate uterus, bicornuate, and the septate uterus or arcuate, all of them, the bigger the abnormality, greater the risk of abortion. An endocrinological upset, most common is progesterone deficiency or corpus luteum deficiency, you know, during early pregnancy. Ji, during early pregnancy, the pregnancy is supported by progesterone, which is produced by corpus luteum. Later on, placenta takes over. If corpus luteum is not functioning well, there will be less progesterone. There will be a higher risk of abortion during first trimester or at the end of first trimester before beginning of second trimester. Because if corpus luteum degenerates, placenta doesn't produce enough progesterone, that is handover, takeover at 12 weeks, then there's again, because of progesterone deficiency, risk of abortion. Then thyroid dysfunction, whether hyperfunction or hypofunction, hypothyroid or hyperthyroid, both can cause, because they lead to endocrinological upset in the body, so lead to risk of abortion. Diabetes, whether type 1 or 2, both are, there's another third type, which is known as gestational diabetes. It appears during pregnancy. All of them, because gestational diabetes appears in second trimester and third trimester, so that's why that name is not in this list. That causes, affects the baby. So gestational diabetes will cause early delivery, a premature delivery, and type of diabetes 1 and 2, they can cause abortion because they also cause abnormality of the fetus. I told you earlier that abnormal fetus is expelled by nature. They don't go on to term. So that's why the incidence of abnormal babies, abnormal people around is only 1%. And if all the abnormal babies were delivered, there would be a large number of abnormal persons, which would be stress or pressure on the society. Then in Pakistan, I talked to you the other day about PCO. PCO, polycystic ovary, and polycystic ovarian disease or syndrome, they are very common. Nearly 40% population of Pakistan is suffering from PCO, polycystic ovary, and syndrome when they are abnormal hormone. Where the PCO girls, first, there's a difficulty in getting pregnant because of anovulation. If at all they do become pregnant, then the risk of pregnancy loss is higher, particularly in first trimester. There's a long list of infections which I've given you: chlamydia, listeria, mycoplasma, neoplasma, sexually transmitted diseases, all of them, HIV, syphilis, streptococcal B colonization, all of them, they are responsible for abortion. And if the infection persists, then they're responsible for repeated abortion, repeated pregnancy loss. And of course, any other infection in the body like typhoid, malaria, because of acute temperature, rise of temperature, there's a, and UTI, there's a risk of abortion. Hepatitis in Pakistan is very common. That too can cause. Immunological factors. You know, it's a great blessing that the fetus and its pregnancy products like placenta, membranes, they are not part of the female body. They could be different in genetically, they could be different blood group, they could be, but they are adjusted or accommodated for 9 months, kept in the uterus. And not only kept, they are given for full nourishment for growth. So it just shows there is adjustment of immunity in female body during pregnancy. But if there are autoimmune diseases like antiphospholipid and cardiolipid or any other autoimmune disease, then those abnormal antibodies will interfere with the accommodation of the mother. So risk of repeated abortions or pregnancy loss is there. Similarly, coagulation defects, same way. Last of all, lifestyle. I would say this is the most important, because out of all the lists which I've named, these are the things which are in the control of the patient. Smoking. Smokers have high risk of abortion. Those who consume alcohol. Those who are addicted to drugs, cocaine, and any other drug. And of course, trauma may be direct or indirect. It can cause abortion. And psychological trauma, shock, any psychological upset. These are separate lists I have made, because whenever a patient is pregnant and she is under your care, you have to advise on these things, that she must avoid smoking, she must avoid alcohol and addictive drugs, and similarly, any trauma, emotional or physical. Now we come to, after the causes, come to types of abortion. Clinically, these are the types which we meet: threatened abortion, inevitable abortion, incomplete abortion, complete abortion, or missed abortion. As a matter of fact, every abortion, if we look at this list, goes through first four. Initially, it is threatened, then it becomes inevitable, then some products are expired, it becomes incomplete, and finally, whatever is left behind, that is also expired, it becomes complete. So whenever you see a patient of abortion, she will be either in any of these four stages: threatened, inevitable, incomplete, or complete. But then the next cause, the next type is missed abortion. In this case, the baby dies, but is still retained inside. As a matter of, when baby dies, it is as good as not being there. But because it has not been expelled, it's retained inside. That is, we call it missed abortion. And the last of all, I'll spend a few minutes on this subtopic, recurrent abortion. Three or more consecutive abortions we call recurrent abortions. They are the patients who are very difficult to handle, difficult to treat, and generally speaking, they need a lot of reassurance. First of all, if a patient comes to you at a stage of threatened abortion, these are the headings which I have discussed for all the four types. There'll be no pain or slight pain, just the beginning of abortion. And similarly, slight bleeding or moderate amount of bleeding. And when you do ultrasound or do pelvic examination, the internal os is closed. And when you do ultrasound, everything is inside the uterus. And baby heart is still there, but some bleeding may be there. Treatment is trying to save this pregnancy. Save this pregnancy. All our treatment will be directed towards the continuing or preserving this pregnancy. That is, continue the pregnancy, provide rest and supportive treatment, which we'll talk in a minute. If the patient comes to you at the stage of inevitable, inevitable means it has reached a stage where you can't stop it. It must happen. Inevitable means it must happen. So it is beyond threatened abortion. When a patient comes to you with threatened abortion, there's a possibility with rest and treatment, you may be able to stop that process and pregnancy may continue. But when she comes to you in a stage of inevitable, it means you can't stop it. The features of this will be, she'll be generally speaking, bleeding more heavily. And when you examine, internal os will be open. Ultrasound will show the pregnant products are still inside the uterus. They are still present, but internal os will be open. And the treatment is, we should help to evacuate that uterus as soon as possible, because generally patients bleed very heavily. So if the patient is at first trimester stage, first 12 weeks of pregnancy, then evacuate by DNC. If the pregnancy is beyond that second trimester, then we put up drip with the drugs which stimulate the uterus to expel the products of conception. Generally, it is oxytocin drip or syntocin drip which helps to expel the products of conception. Well, next stage is after inevitable incomplete. That means the process has reached where part of the products has been expelled, generally the fetus, and part is retained, generally whole of placenta or piece of placenta. In such patients, the history of heavy bleeding previously, if not at that moment, because generally after expulsion of fetus, bleeding does reduce, but still continues. And when you examine, because the placenta is still inside a piece of placenta, os is generally open, and ultrasound shows products of conception, only small piece may be still inside, rest of the fetus and placenta are out. Treatment is generally DNC or evacuation of the uterus. If the patient reaches you at the stage of complete abortion, pain would have stopped, bleeding would have stopped, os is gross, and when you do ultrasound, there's nothing inside the uterine cavity. So in such cases, patient needs only reassurance and explanation or further investigation to find out why it happened. Because patients generally insist and ask repeatedly, Dr. Saab, why it happened? What am I going to do next time? And so you have to answer all those queries patiently, and they take long time to do it. Then next is missed miscarriage. I told you, missed miscarriage means the baby is dead, but still retained inside the uterine cavity. Our products are conceiving, there is no heartbeat, there is no movement. So that's no good pregnancy. It's as good as miscarriage, but the products are still inside. The features are pain, there's no pain, or very dull, irregular pain. Bleeding, irregularly spotting or brownish discharge. Size of the uterus corresponds to the gestation period. So clinically very difficult, because size of the uterus corresponds to the gestation period, and the os is closed, not much of bleeding. Then I tell you, when I was a house surgeon in England, there was no ultrasound to confirm this diagnosis. So it used to be clinical. Clinically, whether it's a normal pregnancy or missed pregnancy, we waited for the pregnancy to grow. If the uterus was growing in size, it means it's a normal pregnancy. If the uterus did not grow, it meant that it was a miscarriage. The patient was admitted with us for a long time, for 2-3 weeks. After that, bleeding stopped. We sent her home and reassured her. But next day, she expelled a dead fetus. So patient was very upset. So those old times, clinically, we could not make proper misdiagnosis. But these days, when you do ultrasound, it confirms instantly by the absence of fetal heart or absence of fetal movements. If that is so, then again, if the dead baby, no fun in continuing pregnancy, evacuation of the uterus should be carried out. For that, you can wait for spontaneous expulsion. Usually, after death of the fetus, 4 to 6 weeks later, spontaneous expulsion does take place. But it's a long wait when the patient knows that the baby is not alive. So in that case, we can stimulate the uterus with oxytocin drip or Cytotec or any other pharmaceutical agents and help to expel the products of conception. If we don't do it, the complication is even the dead products are retained for a long time, they lead to kind of clotting defect, and that means fibrinogen levels reduce, hypofibrinogenemia, it is called. So risk of heavy bleeding. So that's why it is recommended, instead of waiting for 4 to 6 weeks, to expel the products of conception by pharmaceutical agents. And if the patient decides to wait, then every 3-4 days, you estimate fibrinogen levels so that patient does go into thrombocytopenia and suffer from heavy bleeding. Well, if there is only threatened abortion, threat is there, pregnancy is okay. First, we should monitor that by repeated beta ECG tests in early pregnancy. And second is by transvaginal sonography. These two will help you to make sure the baby is alive and growing. And in these cases, bed rest and repeated ultrasound, serial estimation of beta ECG. Beta ECG in early pregnancy becomes double after every 48 hours. If it is 100 today, after 48 hours, it will become 200. After another 48 hours, 200 will become double again, 400. After another 48 hours, 400 will become 800. So these are the tests which we have for monitoring threatened abortion. And if the beta ECG is rising, then it means the pregnancy is normal and you can continue to support the pregnancy so that the bleeding stops and continues the pregnancy. I said that I would spend about 10 minutes or so about repeated pregnancy loss or recurrent abortion. Recurrent abortion is a very important clinical entity because these patients, they get repeated pregnancy loss, repeated loss of pregnancy, and they are very upset. They want you to name the cause and treat the cause. Generally speaking, investigation of these patients lead you to unknown category. That unexplained, we cannot explain why repeated pregnancy loss takes place. So that's why patient gets even more upset. That doctor, if you don't know, what am I going to do? What are you going to do or help me? So that's why it is important topic. The first of all, definition of repeated pregnancy or recurrent abortion is 3 or more consecutive miscarriages. Then those miscarriages could be when there's no live birth before these 3 consecutive miscarriages. That is known as primary repeated pregnancy loss or recurrent abortion. Second is when at least there's 1 live birth and subsequently there's repeated abortion or 3 consecutive abortion. That is further is kind of described as types. All pregnancy losses, no viable birth, or viable pregnancy followed by pregnancy loss. When there is viable birth, pregnancy first and followed by repeated, it's easier to reassure them at least they have a baby. But the first time when there's no viable baby, it is very difficult to reassure or treat those. Sometimes it happens that in between pregnancy losses, there is viable birth. Its etiology is same list which I gave you earlier. Chromosomal anomalies, uterine anomalies, endocrinological upsets, infections, and autoimmune disease, and lifestyle. But out of those, that list of causes, you will name for recurrent abortion only like chromosomal anomaly. If all the babies get same chromosomal anomaly, obviously it's going to persist. And unless you correct the uterine abnormality, particularly, I told you, cervical incompetence, you treat that, the repeated pregnancy loss will be there. Endocrinological upset, if thyroid is abnormal or any other, you have to treat that. And similarly, infections and autoimmune disease, I'll talk in a later while. Well, investigations generally of such patients of repeated abortions is in between two pregnancies. If a patient comes to you with pregnancy loss, 2 or 3, you tell them, before you become pregnant again, let's do some investigation. These are investigations are done at non-pregnant stage. Non-pregnant stage. These are the long list, but I have made it very brief. You can do ultrasound to find out local anomalies, MRI, CT scan, again, for local abnormalities. Hysterosalpingography will show you if there are any abnormalities in the uterine cavity. And Hager's test is to find out cervical incompetence by passing in between pregnancies without dilatation, the dilator up to 6 size. And normally you can't, but in cervical incompetence, because it is patulous, you can pass. Hysteroscopy will show you internal anomalies or Asherman syndrome, and similarly laparoscopy will confirm other causes present in the pelvis, and test for presence of infection. If you suspect any of those list of infections, their test can find out, and maybe the treatment of that infection or elimination or eradication will help the patient in getting live baby or viable pregnancy. And test for antibodies, antiphospholipid antibodies, anti-nuclear antibodies, they'll show if the cause of repeated pregnancy loss is presence of antibodies. Just a short list out of those causes. If the cervical incompetence, second trimester abortions usually take place. The abortion is silent. Suddenly, patient gets gush of fluid and painless abortion, because cervix is so easily opened that there's no pain. Or pain is usually in during delivery or abortion for getting cervical dilatation. Here, dilatation is present or easily achieved without pain, and spontaneous expression of the fetus takes place. The treatment is cervical circular, for first making a diagnosis, I told you, in between pregnancies. Then cervical circlage after 12 to 14 weeks. There are two types, Shirotka stitch or McDonald stitch. I will not go into details of that. Generally, McDonald stitch is more popular than Shirotka stitch. Although Shirotka from Bombay was the first person who described this as a cause of second trimester abortion. If the infection is there, confirm the diagnosis, treat specific antibiotics. But generally speaking, those infections, particularly when they become chronic, are difficult to eradicate. But you can still prescribe, and maybe some patients get help out of it. If there's endocrinological cause, then obviously, if there is thyroid, you will treat that. And if there's luteal phase defect, it can be supported by giving exogenous progesterones, either orally or by injections. PCO and hypersecretion of prolactin, they can be treated by specific therapy. Luteal phase defect and progesterone deficiency, there's a lot of debate whether it should be given or not, because most of the time, even making a definitive diagnosis, progesterone is natural hormone, progesterones are synthetic products which have actions like progesterone. The progesterones are prescribed from outside, either in the form of tablets or by giving injection throughout pregnancy, but preferably up to 20 weeks. If there's autoimmune disease like systemic lupus erythematosus, the risk of pregnancy loss in those patients is 20%, and mostly second, third trimester. And similarly, antiphospholipid antibodies, is again, pregnancy loss is high, 15%. And treatment of these are low molecular weight heparin injection daily 40 milligram, 40 to 60 milligram, and low dose aspirin for 75 milligram daily orally, and sometimes the cortisone or steroids, they can be given particularly for anti-nuclear antibodies. Well, good news is, in spite of loss of three pregnancies, patient gets very upset after losing one pregnancy. Then you have to investigate, reassure. After a while, she sort of relaxes, becomes pregnant, then second loss. If she loses three consecutively recurrent abortions, it's very difficult to reassure her or to even investigate and pinpoint the cause. But even if you don't pinpoint the cause, I tell you, chances of survival in fourth pregnancy after three pregnancy loss is still 50%. So in such cases, reassurance and psychological support, they are most important, because eventually, after repeated attempts, 75% of live births in unexplained repeated abortions take place. They succeed, and 50% of miscarriages, no cause is found, unfortunately. But this I put down because patient comes to you, you do all kinds of investigation, still you do not tell her that the cause and effect, because you have not found one. No cause is found. Patient gets more upset with you. Doctor, you have done so many tests. They have been coming to you for so many weeks or months. How come? But in 50% cases, we do not find the cause. But still, as I said earlier, 75% repeated pregnancy losses or abortions, they succeed in having a live birth. I put this as the last slide. When you don't find any cause, you tell the patient, I don't know why you keep losing, because you've done all the thorough investigation. That long list of causes which I made, you have investigated all of them. You have not pinpointed, you have not found anyone leading to that repeated loss. But empirically, generally speaking, in we give empirical support, that means without finding the cause, we use hormones, we use metformin, and if diabetic, tight glycemic control or heart, thyroid, make sure is normal, aspirin or heparin and folic acid, rest, and last of all, prayer for success of the treatment. Thank you. I have given you 9 MCQs. Please do send your comments. Every time I make a request, I have received no comment at all, no suggestion at all. I would appreciate if you do that, which will be a great help to me, because I would feel more satisfied with my talk or lecture, because the purpose is to give you what you need. And unless I satisfy your needs, no fun in talking. So that's why I keep requesting, please let me know. There's a comment about this talk. Please include case discussions or clinical scenarios would be very helpful in understanding. If you go to YouTube, I have got more than 100 lectures on YouTube. All those are first this presentation of the clinical case, then discussion on that. So it will be a great help. You don't have to listen to all the 100 lectures. The topic you are interested, you'll find there, because 100 lectures means most of the topics are covered. So in that series of lectures, first there was a case presentation, and then we discuss the case of that particular problem. So this I'm doing it in this format because perhaps it will cover the subject as you need in the examination. Next.